Hi everyone, I'm Dhruv and I have Praveen here with me and HasGeeks is hosting us and thank you Ambika and Nanditi and everyone Amok for this session and it's nice to find people who associate with the kind of work and the narrative you're doing. So it's really nice to be here. And so we're going to talk about something called achar. And achar is a smelly food that Indians eat. And the good part of achar is, the best part of achar is that you put some ingredients and you wait for a while for some magic to happen. And in some time, the ideas actually take some form which you had intended. So I think that was an idea, that basically the act of pickling ideas. And how design actually helps in planning ahead for a perfect pickle. And the session today is about design's identity as a catalyst for reimagining futures, which are not singular. They are plural in the sense that they are iterative. They are not headed to a singular direction. They are not predictions of any sort. They are just preferential imaginations of designers, that how they think that future might be. So, and most of the processes that we are going to share of people and of the things that we have done, all of them have one trait in common, that all of them are very inclusive. They are very inclusive of the community that they are based out of. They're inclusive in terms of participation and yeah, so moving on, introducing what I think, Praveen, you have the controls. Yeah.
Yes.
So A4 or achar. So char is 4 and achar is A4 and hence this name. And what we are a designer duo and we map toolkits in the sense we try to create toolkits which help map out a preferential future in a particular domain. And this includes processes of speculation and futures thinking and writing fictions in design and imagining scenarios and understanding what are the evidences of those scenarios in the present and how do you create meaningful artifacts which effectively represent or symbolize a future that you're trying to put forward. And on the right top, you can see 5-6 words which are about us. So I would like to very specifically focus on one word, which is fun. And this process actually came out of this entire idea of, you know, me and Praveen working together on something that is beyond the present temporal frame was because that we were like kind of feeling a certain boredom in serving the present capital interests that design does. And we were very lucky to be, you know, stumbling upon some things that we have read in the past few years, and they really led us to what we are doing today. Moving on. Yeah. Why are we here? So Praveen just queued in the GIF a little earlier. So usually when we talk about the work that we do, so comprehension is a big problem in terms of people, that people usually do not understand the value in doing speculations, and we have to explain them to this this to them in a very simpler fashion. So why are we here is exactly this session holds a particular importance for us. Most of the work that we do, Praveen, I think we can do away with the GIF now. It's quite distracting, and but it's fun. So what we are doing is that usually, just a second, there's a participant saying that she's not able to receive any audio. There's something she can do. I think you can just, she's not receiving audio. I think someone can help her out, probably.
Yeah, we look into it. You can just continue talking.
So most of the work that we do is very contextual. For instance, like in the past few years, we have been delving into crafts and reimagining craft practices. And so usually what we understand about any new idea coming forward in terms of craft practices or in terms of community in general, is that it should be inclusive. It should be based upon the community itself. So part of the reason of this webinar happening is that we want to interact with the community. We want to get our ideas out there and receive some reflection upon it from each of you who are coming from your own particular domains and actually reflect upon the toolkit that we will share and the ideas that we will share. And collaboration, I think, is a way forward for if you want to do something truly transdisciplinary and interdisciplinary. I think more people need to talk to each other. So that is the primal reason that we are here. And moving on. Try to start with some examples of what speculative design has been. Some examples of speculative design are very popular, but then we just try to go with the ones that we particularly associated with a lot. So this is a cookbook by Next Nature Network. They're amazing people doing some truly fantastic work. You should just go check them out right away after the webinar. And so the book is called, it's a book, it's an actual product that you can go buy on Amazon. And the book is called 45 Recipes You Cannot Cook Yet. So the whole paradigm is that they're speculating upon the future of lab-grown meat. If you have a certain DNA of a certain animal, you can actually, with the present technologies, you can grow a piece of meat or some cells of meat very easily in a lab. And so some designers, some, I would like to say, people who capitalize upon this idea, and they thought of a cookbook that might just exist in the future. So this is like a particularly good introduction to what speculative design can do. It can give you a very evidential and a very tangible visual into a particular future that you're imagining. Moving on, the next example. So this is a very new thing. I just saw it on Instagram a few days back, and this is by two researchers. I cannot pronounce their names, I'm so sorry. But then you can find their work on Speculative Edu is a channel. If you click on the Internet of Dogs heading, the red one, so you can just go to the link directly. So we have embedded all the links in the presentation, and we'll share the presentation with you once the webinar is over. And so this is a very critical mapping of what a entertainment system for a dog would look like in the future. So they have actually understood that more dogs are being left at home. And so what might the future look like if you want to entertain your dog when you're not at home? And you can see the controls, and you can see the, for some of us, it might just be a doodle with some annotations, but it actually is a very interesting question into what entertainment for another species would look like. Designers have always indulged in creating and entertaining humans, since we are humans, but then can we really employ empathy to generate entertaining content for another species? So that is the bigger question that arises here. And moving on, Praveen. So another great example of what a speculative project or a project that tries to artifact futures can do. So this is a 99-cent shop. This is a pretty common visual in US. And so what these people have done is that they have imagined the 99-cent shop in a particular future where certain products can be easily availed, like a DIY organ transplant kit, and a currency converter. So what these products actually tell us is that the designer is actually going through the effort of mapping out a future where this product, a DIY organ transplant kit, holds some importance and is a part of a greater system. So I think that is the takeaway from such projects. And this is another studio called Extrapolation Factory who do amazing work. And it's more like an event that happens at a certain community. They go inside and create something with the community. Again, a very inclusive format. You guys should just go check them out. And moving on. I think Praveen would like to explain this.
Okay, so we are going back to, I think, one of the first examples we saw on speculative design. This is a Hertzian chair, Faraday chair from Hertzian Tales, from Anthony Dune and Fiona Raby. I think whoever has heard about speculative design, they know like Dune and Raby and their work. So we wanted to keep this example at the end. We show the starting, like how we started with criticizing even our daily lives. Okay, so this example is about how you could be truly at peace in a society where everything is, connected through wireless communication or wireless waves. So it gives you a resting space where none of these electromagnetic waves can, interfere with what is happening with you inside. So this is one of the examples which we wanted to share with you before we start, I think, about speculative design. Okay, so before starting speculative design, I'll just touch upon what is discursive design, because since we have been also reading a lot of content or literature over this. So this model of discursive design was given by Thap. Okay, and it shows the current context which we speak about. You know, when we are talking to most of the designers in our community, this is the first question which occurs, like speculative design is criticized in itself that it is useless in the sense because it's out of the traditional design area. And it is, like, we accept that it is outside the traditional design space. But what happens with the discursive design practices where you sort of talk about things, you start asking these questions which may be reflective upon the practices, internal or external of the industry or even our lives. Okay, and from that we generate something which starts the stream of critical design practices where we are actually asking or reflecting upon practices from the traditional design or industrial design space. So like even in the Faraday chair, like you can see it is not a chair, right? But it is, they named it chair. So that was the part of critical design we started with. And from there we start going into speculative design practices where you sort of envision future, taking into consideration that it will be outside the traditional design. But considering more of a, like a socio-technical future which can exist in the in few years maybe, or few decades, or maybe few centuries. Moving on, we have this presentation right now because I think even we are trying to unravel what is speculative design, and you could see like it's sort of a mix of a lot of things, and it helps us understand, okay, so speculative design has a component of critical design, design fiction, and design, art, science, okay, like futures thinking, but thing is, there is a space which is missing here, I will say, which is on purpose, something about user-centered design, which has become a lot prominent nowadays, along with design thinking. So you could see like design thinking is having a space there, in speculative design practices. So what we understood, like we are also navigating this space with community in ourselves, because when we converse with people, then we understand the differences, like where are we standing with speculative scenarios. Then we come to Future Scone. Dhruv, True.
Yeah,
I think Drew will take over from there.
Yeah, very, very evident relaying we are doing. Yeah. So
yes.
Coming to future gone. So this is like a, this was honestly, like for me, this was the starting point of you know, research into this area. This particular visual from a book called Speculative Everything, and what it says essentially is that there are, if you see the broadest spectrum, it's of possible futures. There are a lot of possible futures that can just happen. If you took the, if you take the conditions today and the details today, it can amount to a lot of possible futures, you know, which can be shifts of power, changes in economy, global warming, and the health of the planet coming into account very recently, unfortunately. And then there are a narrower spectrum as plausible futures. And then there is another narrow spectrum called probable futures. So preferable futures are somewhere between probable futures and plausible futures. And this is where intention comes in. The red part is the intention of a particular designer, of a visionary, or a technologist, or a, for anyone, any citizen of the system. So designers are just one standpoint of this system, and there are many people affecting change. So we have to take that into account also. So moving on, what have we been up to? So we've been up to a lot of things. And again, just that Praveen just likes too much. We have been up to a lot of, how do you say, messing around. That is what we have been doing. And I think we can do it with Jeff now. Yeah. So we have been talking to a lot of people. We have been attempting many open calls, and we have been drafting our researches. And essentially what we have been up to is we have been articulating some of our own ideas through some toolkits that we generated. And initially the idea of speculation into crafts came from a singular idea of a future that we imagined. And hence we understood that just one idea of a future isn't enough. We need to like really understand the process that we are going through and probably share that with the community so that we can have more people talking about the things that we want to talk about. And so moving on, we moved to the first project that we kind of articulated. So we wrote this, this project was a, I would say it was a very textual imagination. We imagined it in terms of text only. The visual was associated a little later. So what this project was that we imagined a certain, so I am from Jaipur, and Jaipur is a place where there are a lot of crafts happening all the time, every time, in every corner. And the pandemic has really affected a lot of crafts because most of them are from an area which is the containment zone. Most of the crafts are from containment zones. And so unfortunately that is the scenario right now. But then what we had imagined like in 2018 is that there is a lot of data that generates when a craftsman works. You know, let's say there is a person who is working with metal pots or any craft for that matter. So with the visual data, the tactile data, the tool usage data, and the form generation data, the aesthetic data. So we tried to sort of understand what are the various data points that are being generated from a traditional craftsman. And the ethic of this was, I think one very important thing about choosing your preferences when articulating futures is that you should have an ethical system, because it really acts as a guardian, a guideline as you move along the project. So one ethic of our system, predetermined ethic, was that whatever data is being generated, it should benefit the craftsman in some form or the other. And later on, we materialized that idea in the sense that probably a skill profile of a craftsman can be extracted from the work that he is doing. And usage of that skill profile in a 3D prototyping or a robotic system might just help the craftsman also So that was the basic idea, and we ventured into a lot of domains, like what would be the interactions of a particular craftsman in the future, what would the fabrication system look like. So you can see we have, in the visual also, we have included a small tripod or a pentapod mounted robot, which might just help the craftsman in performing tasks that are repetitive and probably do not include a lot of human decisions, and the craftsman can really focus upon areas which really require human intention and decision making. So that was the idea, and we included a chair also. That means the craftsman can just relax for a while. So here what we thought is that apprentices can assume a digital identity, since a sociological trends amongst communities of craftsmen in India is that the young generation doesn't want to pick up crafts because they just have very different lifestyle needs. And I think that also needs to be taken into account, that probably the young do not have aligned interests anymore. And probably machines can serve the craftsman in a more meaningful way for his benefit or her benefit. And moving on, Praveen. Another workshop, the next project of ours was a workshop thing where this was triggered by the anti-CAA protests that were happening. And amongst the international media, we also saw trends of dissents taking form. And as we can see right now, it's a lot of dissent in the world right now. And so dissent became a very interesting topic amongst friends also, and community of designers, and where I teach with my students, and I know Praveen also, this was the topic of the temporal timeline that we were in that time. And so we actually thought of, like, what is dissent? It is defying a norm, probably. It is questioning the norm of any kind, be it government, be it culture, be it tradition. So you can have dissents, which is in the family. You can disagree with your parents. You can disagree with your children. That is a dissent that we can also experience. So we really understood the emotion of dissent. And with a group of around 15 to 20 people, we came with the idea of a lot of different types of dissent. So these are actually works of different participants. And if you go to the link, you can see their names as well. And so this, I would like to discuss just one of them. So because it just found relevance very recently. So this Touch Me Not project, this happened in January this year. And the Corona, I think the talks were just starting at that time in India. And like we had a little snippet of a news that China is experiencing this virus, and it just came out. And it really wasn't such a scary time just earlier this year. And at that time, when we did this work, one of the groups actually came up with this idea that possibly a pandemic might rise, where this sense of touch or the feeling of touch or the mere act of touch is like a non-accepted social cultural norm. What might that society look like? What happens when we lose the luxury of touch over a long period of time? So I think that found very interesting relevance. And we'll be putting the discussions over the next half, which will just come very soon. So we can have an open mic session that time. All right, Binil, I think you were asking that you wanted to join. So moving on. And like while we are continuing the presentation, you guys can just type in, we can start a conversation on chat as well, because I think that functions better. And once we are done with our narrative, we'll just open up the mic. All right, Praveen, I think you would like to.
Okay, so this is something which we have been working since, I think, last 3-4 months. This is called Speculative Craft Apprentices. So, I mean, continuing our, you know, how we could speculate about craft, we thought that, okay, there has been discussion through the perspective of, a social ecosystem or even government ecosystem or commercial ecosystems. But what about the apprentices? Because when we talk, we used to find the major thing that the son doesn't want to continue the father's craft practices most of the time. They want to shift to cities or they want to have a different lifestyle. So we thought in our context, in Indian craft traditional context, the apprentices are generally family members or somebody who you are related to. So we thought that, okay, what if we look at speculative crafts from the perspective of apprentices? So we started this discussions with among our groups in, you know, like with design, different design practitioners. There were people from different background also. We were not just talking to designers. So that gave us a very interesting perspective. We had sessions with design students. What do they think about it, since they are more of the same age, a similar age of the you know, the newer apprentices. And we were having these, we just the thing was, like, it was going all disarray since it has been a beaten down discussion. So it was going all the way to different areas. So we thought that we will put few boundaries in discussions, which was like, you know, when we are speculating, these are those ethical boundaries that Dhruv was talking about, that we should have crafts which benefits itself, right? Like, if you're looking forward, the craft should benefit, right? And maybe the craft practices should continue. And technology should not act as a replacement, which is the major concern when we are talking about industrial production, because most of the criticism is coming from the industrial production means replacing the Indian craftsmen generally. So for that, what we used to do was, we used to have a workshop period where we used to discuss. So our primary thing we understood through our processes, we want to discuss first to understand how the particular topic or particular thing is taken in the community, right? So we were just doing these discussions of Indian craft, apprentice and technology, like how people are looking at these three things during like a hour or a 2 hour session. So we'll get these points. So what happened, like, after having two, three these discussions among the communities, we understood that there are some patterns. So we created a toolkit out of it. So this is the first part of the toolkit, which is like, you have to sort of define an apprentice, like, because we understood, like, everybody understand apprentice in their own context. So we thought that if we want to speculate on apprenticeship, then it's better that we understand, like, what is apprentice for everyone, right? Or for that particular person who want to speculate on it. And maybe what are the ways of exchanging skills and how to, you know, communicate with the craft masters? Because then we wanted to understand, like, we wanted to keep craft as a continuing practice. So we wanted to understand, like, how you think they exchange skills. Something like, right now we know that craftsmen started using WhatsApp a lot, which was not there in the earlier communication, even with the e-commerce as a participant in the ecosystem. So WhatsApp was a game changer in this sense. And then the second step we thought after discussing was something of, there's a 2x2 matrix. So what we observed in our discussions was like, you know, people were sort of taking spaces or taking parts in this grid. Either people were saying that craft is based out of human emotions and human skills, and maybe there were perspectives from engineers also where we were like, craft is just tools and techniques, because there were questions like, is making a computer chip is a craft, which is mainly done by computer programs right now, right? And then there was this perspective where crafts were seen as a community practice, because it's actually an ecosystem, or craft is seen as a solo or individual practice, you know, like what we have with artists generally. So we divided this thing for starting as a trigger to speculate, because we wanted people to, you know, stay in one space and then speculate, so that the biases don't affect their future generally. After this, we just had a sort of imaginative name and what for idea of future craft practice you think there will be. And then we asked people that, how do you think a particular journey in that craft will look in 2050? So how maybe an apprentice is working in 2050 and in those type of scenarios, right? And so this was the basic three-step toolkit which we were working with. We did it with two, three groups. and we found, okay, what type of imagination people are coming, because there were like questions coming with where one in one workshop somebody said that is parenting a craft, right? So then do we ask start questioning parenting also? So how do we learn parenting, right? So those type of interactions were coming when we were trying out this toolkit, which is very interesting for us. So what happened after that, we thought that, okay, let's just, go ourselves with it, like do our own intensive session with it. So we both started on this path. So what we did was, this is something which I did. So I mapped the concept of apprentice for me, and then I triggered through, I chose four different futures from the four different quadrants and named them something like Echo, which was like a solo practice where craft is tech and tools. You don't require human transition. Something like Blossom, which is a solo practice and where craft is human skills. So the names were coming from extremities. So one, I'll just show you like one result, which is like, we have made four different results for these. So this is like a final output. We decided that, okay, this is a map for this future, which is called Echo, where individual craft practices are there based on tools and technique. And we defined, or we imagined this, that, okay, the apprentice is just like a craft service provider, right? He's not creating anything new, but he's just a service provider. So he has these workbenches, which he could, get a order from the AR marketplace, and he will, or VR virtual marketplace, and then he will, these robots are given order, and they pick up some materials from the bottom, and they start creating this object which looked something like this. We gave a very weird wireframe, and since they are, it's just a craft service provider, it is not their main job. They are just doing it as a part-time gig since, so we also started doing backcasting with it, like how the story went after Corona, like how people started migrating or leaving this craft practice, going to cities, and then maybe, there's a revivalist movement sort of where people started digitizing these craft practices, and they come up with these workstations, which they started distributing among our family members and things like that. So this is what we have been doing since the last 3-4 months on the craft practice. What is next? Dhruv, you want to get on this? Since there is a lot of things we have been talking about, what is next? And even this session, which is happening right now, is part of that, what we will be doing next. So we are sort of looking for more participation in people, where we want to have discussions over different topics, which is coming from community, right? We want to have your topics, which we would like to discuss, and then come up with these custom toolkits, which are specific to those areas. And we look at how we could imagine a future or make some sort of a guideline based on that. Okay, the office standoff, yes.
Yeah, and
okay,
these are some other names that you can look at. These are some things that are happening right now, and most of the design community would just know this. And this is where we also kind of get a lot of research material from. So we're just sharing that. Most of our hypotheses are based upon their hypotheses. So, yeah. That's the kind of community. And so basically the GIF also meant that we're looking for more community participation, starting now that we have shared kind of the work that we have done over the last 2 years, I think, since we have been working together, Praveen and I. And we would like to have more avenues. Now, moving on from craft, I think craft was more closer to home, so to say, because I live in Jaipur and I am from an institute that taught me a lot about crafts. And so it has been a very integral part of my life since the last 10 years. I think 2010, I started my formal education with crafts and design. And since then, so we are kind of looking at new avenues that kind of domains that we can move into. And since people here are from a lot of varied backgrounds, we'll just open the mic now. And anyone who wants to speak can just raise their hands if they have any questions. If you have any questions and you want to comment or you want to suggest something, so I think it can help us all, because that is pretty much the content we had to show. And thank you, HasGeek, Zainab and Amog, thank you. I haven't interacted with everyone, but then we have been in touch in some form or the other. And thank you, Ajayabhar, Ambika and Nandati. And you guys do some really amazing work. I keep sharing it with my students all the time. And I think more discussions are more, I think we are really happy that we got this place to speak, just express our ideas. I think that was pretty much it. That is why we do it. I think that we can just share it at some point with the community. And we can have some question and answers or comments or anything. And you guys can just raise your hand.
You have two questions on chat, guys.
Right. Would you guys like to just speak the questions out? And we can have a conversation. Akku, can we have a conversation?
Hey, hi, Dhruv. Can you hear me?
Hi, Akku. Hi, how?
Hey, hi, Praveen. Yeah. It was a nice presentation. I could only grasp few things. Didn't know much about all these. Not in my background, so. But I had this one question regarding this, like, suppose you have a design and so how do you know you can manufacture it about that apprentice? Like, how do you model it? Like, can this be produced, feasible or not? Because I have a lot of design in mind, but maybe it's not even possible right now, given the limitations of like machinery or craftsmen available. Something like that. So
yeah, but this is a very valid question, and this is the I think this is the very primal question that we get. So most of our process, if you look at it, it is based upon evidences that we can find today, and backcasting really helps you. Like, if I can effectively map out where we have moved since the last 10 years till the I think the present day, and I think we can effectively take the projection of where might a technology lead. That, for example, an AR marketplace doesn't exist right now, but then it is very much feasible with the machinery we have right now. And most of our ideas, let's say the Apprentice 4.0 idea that we showed. Go back to that slide, Igor.
Yeah.
The sketched.
This one? No.
The earlier one, like the initial one. So I think that can be a good exemplar. So, okay. So most of the things that are happening in this visual, let's say, so this particular robotic product already exists, and the technology to convert a visual into a profile, we chose some proof of concept. So this is a very interesting thing that most designers, and I think most engineers also have this, that we have something called a proof of concept.
Yeah.
So actually encountered upon some ideas which are using similar technology, and Praveen being an engineer, so he can actually account for if this can be with a particular effort, can this happen in this domain also. So I think we have proofs and references heavily attached to any text we write. And they come.
So even like I would like to add, like, you know, this also tells this community also, right? Like, you should also maybe talk to engineers, maybe other industry people. So the thing is, it becomes more, you know, like real that this realistic thing can happen actually through discourses only.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's more like an experience basis, like asking an engineer, like what has been showing it. Something like that, is it?
Right. It's mostly a lot of it's speculation. What it is, like, speculation is the right word. You actually pick on some ideas that are happening right now, and then you try to very effectively articulate that how might this, what might this grow into, or what all might this grow into.
Okay.
The And most of these are not predictions. Again, I would want to say that these are not in any way predictions. These are just preferential futures that a designer is trying to assert, or a person, whoever is creating this future, is trying to assert. For example, if you look at this very effectively, we can see this in like Hollywood movies, like Stanley Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey. So in that, till up until that point of time, the possibility of inducing gravity in a spacecraft with rotation of the spacecraft hasn't happened till now, up until the point of International Space Station probably. And at that time, with the available theories about space exploration and looking at various physical models, or because after I think a certain number of years, 5 or 6 years, US launched their first space program. So Stanley Kubrick gave a vision which wasn't very accurate, but it was not flawed in physics, I would say. So I think that is the kind of expertise that we are also trying to reach, where you can effectively predict, imagine a technology or a sociocultural trend growing into. So I think that is more of a question here. What might photography be? What might food look like? And given the trends happening today, so I think that is more of the domain that we are taking. It's, I think there is a lot of art involved also. This can be considered as a statement of art also in certain contexts. It's not pure in our pure, yeah.
Sounds good. Yeah.
Thank you. And
we have a question. I think so. Sovani is there. Ardhe is there. And Yathath.
So we can get the mic to Yathath. Would you like to have the mic? I think you can speak if you want to.
Hello. Hi everyone.
Hey Yathath.
Hey, yeah. Really confused what to say. But like I feel since I've also been working in a similar domain recently, I feel like we were having a discussion in the chat right now around the speculative design and how this whole word speculative design has a baggage of RCA, Antoniner and Rabi Primer. It's all very hyper fashionable European things, which are these it does not work in India. Like the way we look at it in India, we want to have that when we say we are speculative designer, it comes with the, you can't even connect with a lot of designers in your own community, because it just comes with like, you are like, it's very fashionable, you're very stylized. I think what's very important for this project also, like to build a community in India, is that it should be very participatory, that this idea of future should not come from us. Like, we are not speculative designers. We are the maybe facilitators. The idea of who, the, like Anab Jain from Superflux is an interesting thing. The people who have the least power to shape their future suffer the worst consequences of it.
Yeah.
So that's very, that's somewhere we have to focus. If you have to build a community, that we don't have to prescribe futures. Ki bhavish mein, matlab India mein aise meat ugega. India mein flying cars hogi, jisme kahi ke leather ka kuch laga hua. I don't know. Like, but it should be very, the idea that future should be given back to the community. That ki agar hum craftsmen are, we should ask the craftsmen what their future is. We should have the workshops with the craftsmen, what they think their future is. Maybe the idea of the future is very simple. Maybe I did something like this and it ended up ki mere bacche ko khana mile, wahi mera future hai. Matlab,
yeah. No, so we also had this discussion, you know, like where we want to have
a... somewhere we should focus a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's very much valid. And this is the question I also have in most conferences when I attend as a viewer. With some futures organization, which is based in let's say LA or the Silicon Valley. Most of them are based out of either German cities of Europe and Silicon Valley in the US. And this is a question that I also have, looking at the current trends of economy and the capitalistic, expansion, aggravated expansion going on, that if you talk of a green future, that just seems so, distant from what is actually happening. Or if you look at the... I would also like to add to this then, Jaipur in particular, most of our craft premises are based out of the experiences that we've had in the community of Jaipur. And Jaipur, due to some architectural planning, actually what happened in Jaipur is that it was very effective architectural planning at a certain point of time, which included urban systems also. So craftsmen were kind of a priority at certain point of time. I'm not saying that they are still right now, or they have the same societal strata, but then at a certain point of time, they were the center point of the industry of that particular walled city or the old city area, which we call it right now, which was the planned city of Jaipur. And Sawai Jai Singh, I think, was the king who facilitated everything of this, and he also came from a planning background. So if you look at the craft systems today in Jaipur, they're not as bad. Like most of the craftsmen that I have worked with, they come from I'm just taking this a wild guess, because you pick on cues how the person lives and what are his aspirations. And but then the aspiration set is pretty evolved, I would say. It is not in the bottom strata of the hierarchies. And Jaipur has been able to give the craft community that thing, I think. And most of the karigars here, like most of the people that I studied with in the college called IICD, five or six of them, like my closest friends, were from craft practicing families of Kutch or Assam, or from Jaipur itself, from Bikaner, from Barmer, and they had very different sets of aspirations, I would say. And I think I would agree to this, that we do really need some very indigenous ways, local ways, and community-driven ways of predicting or choosing a preferential future in terms of India. I think that is very much required, and I think we are in that pursuit right now. And Dan,
okay.
Stepping point.
Okay, so like Yathath, like this discussion has been done a lot with Dhruv and me, and sometimes I come with a very opposite view and I say, let the crafts die, because maybe I like the idea of a heritage of a craft, let's say. Because the young person tells me that he doesn't want to do craft. He wants to go and live in a city and maybe work as a serviceman for somebody else, a better earner, better health and those things. So if I prefer that, then I choose that, okay, let's let the crafts die. Okay, so when this thing comes and there is, this discussion happens and we come to a balance in between. Yeah, but I also have this view sometimes that, okay, maybe crafts, how we envision right now, which is associated with particular group of people, should die. Because maybe it's not working for them, and maybe there should be a new way of looking at craft, or maybe it can be called something else, right? That comes up in a different community, or a community which has stabilized this economical preference. Okay, so like this is another view we have. So this is just like great to discuss these different views. So, I would also say that once after thinking that, I understand that's a very, maybe extreme view, and we come to a conclusion that, okay, yeah, we want to benefit craft in essence, or at least craftsmen.
Yeah, but who's stopping, sorry, I'm interjecting, but I just feel like who's stopping us being craftspeople as well? Like, if you're making AR filters, like, why are you necessarily quote unquote a designer? Like, maybe you are also crafting it, you know, like, so I think this agenda that we've been fed for so many years through you know, our design educations of looking at them as the other, and while continuously feeling guilty about it and simultaneously feeling we need to do something for them. Whereas not looking at ourselves as designers who have all the same skills in the studio that we've learned, call ourselves, we still designers. Call ourselves designers. We don't call ourselves craftspeople.
Because
I mean, at the end of the day, most of us are actually just doing project management, right? So why aren't we calling ourselves project managers?
Exactly.
That's very true.
So many Hi, Praveen Dhruv. Thanks. This was a great discussion. Thanks for starting it off, actually. And actually, I'll also take off from Ambika's point. I think it's a very interesting point because I think, like, it's also the question of where, like, design education began for India, you know, and at this point of time, if you're looking at speculative frameworks, and in a way, the speculative frameworks have also been set by a very Eurocentric point of view, the cone of possible futures, the Stuart cone, which was adopted by Dun and Rabi, and now we are kind of trying to, like Yathart said, it's almost like a sort of, it's trending in a certain way, and how do we...
Yeah.
Sort of like, take from it, but then also make it our own. I think this question has been haunting design in general, because even the setting up of design education, if I look at, say, NID and the whole Ray and Eames sort of model, which was, again, a very white sort of, centric model, let's come and, rescue the craftsmen from their whatever lives and, give them better livelihoods. So that sort of a thing is, I think it's been haunting, the field of design in general. So, and now looking at speculative design again as a genre, as a category that we kind of want to think through, I think requires us to return to some fundamental questions, which is probably the reason why I think the question of agency is one. And the question of, even the future, the question of the future is also, I think, a critical question because, I mean, time in the present is also actually arriving from the future. We are already in a speculative world. You know, the economy is a speculative, technology is a speculative. So how are we thinking of a future as something that's further away from us rather than in the now? So I think these are some of the questions that kind of we could probably even think about, together.
Yeah.
I think that's very important to understand how a particular what I take away from what you said is that how a particular intention of a future is affecting
absolutely the intention. Right. And also how I think, if you look at dystopic fiction, right? So that's also dystopia has become the Netflix trend. It's become so consumable in a certain way. And a lot of speculative design collapses with dystopic fiction. So I think some of these things, they become almost escapist rather than kind of bringing conversations about agency.
Even the same thing happened in the last session when we were doing through those grids, about craft, and that was one aspect where I didn't want it to go into a dystopic future. So even in one of the version, we thought that the craft practice will still remain the same, where it's a community driven human practice, so people will still be using the old weave, potter's wheel, to work in the village. But we thought that maybe the paradigm of working full-time craftsmen will change to something like a seasonal craftsman. So they become craftsmen during only a period of time. So that's what we wanted to have. After having these discussions, we understood that in our community of people in Indian perspective, even if we are not belonging to that community, we have a different perspective of looking at it. So in our sessions, I think none of us went into a dystopic future at all. And that was very good, thing I noticed.
Right.
Just to add, Praveen was following you and stuff. I did a thesis on this topic only. So I would just put the link here. And it was all these discussions, I dealt with them last year. And it was, I'm just taking a break from it for now. I'll just put it in the link. It's like all the research I've done.
Yathath, do you mind if I put this link in the HasGeek comments so later if somebody comes to the
page? Yeah, yeah, it's totally fine.
Perfect.
Vinil, you wanted to have an input?
Yeah, Praveen. Good to see the work kind of shaping up. So I just want to ask whether have you guys been able to map the data sets related to the act of craft-based making, and does it lead to, you know, any cues or any patterns arising out from that?
I think, am I audible?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, I think right now, Vinil, we're not actually going in that direction of taking cues from the act of the craft.
Okay.
I think we are just like all the development that we have done, which we are presenting, and the kind of the way that we have also taken is mostly based upon, you know, the socio-cultural placement of the craft and how technology affects it.
Okay.
In certain sense, in terms of market or in terms of logistics or in terms of creation of the product or in terms of material, how technology affects the craft into a certain future.
Okay.
Or future.
Okay.
Yathath, thank you for this. And this is a very interesting document. Okay. So, do we have more questions? Or anything? There's one.
Yeah. So, hi, guys. I'm Anuj. So, I have this question regarding that, like how you said crafts and the future, right? So maybe sometimes you speculate and overemphasize on technology part, or else, like if we are proceeding towards that future, maybe then we should focus more on embedding the knowledge into the local craftsmen so that they can start working with the technology. Just like how after industrialization, we had the robotic arms, right? Which said that, okay, these will take away the jobs of the people, but then it didn't, right? Because people started to learn how to adapt and work with them.
Right.
So I guess that's where some it lies, like how you can start to mold it.
Yeah, I think that is a very, that is the way we also look at it, like that a particular technological barrier should, innovation, a particular technological innovation or invention should not replace the human. It should rather extend the human, and the human needs to understand how to extend through the innovation. So I think that is what you are also saying, that we need to understand what skills might we need to learn as craftsmen and as part of the craft ecosystem for that particular future to happen. I think
definitely.
Is the affect that we are also looking at as a statement, that if you want this particular aspiration set in the future, then this is the process to do that.
Because like as you said,
we
always look at, when we say craftsmen, we always look at the people with weaving baskets or pottery, like
right.
Very traditional, but we are ignoring the digital craftsmen that we are here today. So how can you start to bridge that gap? So maybe that's what interesting tech part also comes, like if you just take machine learning, the GAN networks. So if you could start to collect various data from all these like weavings, let's say weavings as a base, right? But weavings in various part of the country, there are so many different types and the way they use. So how that could come together, maybe then with help of the GAN networks, we can optimize and find certain things, so as a result with which we can further interact with the locals. So I think that, and yeah, regarding to the science fiction, it has always been dystopian. I don't think there has anywhere a utopia yet, or it won't be ever. So
yeah,
I think we should anticipate and these things.
I think this can be a very interesting cue for the next activity also that we are planning with the group. So probably we can take into consideration these things. And since we have some people determined into, can I just ask you, what do you do, Anuj?
So, I am an architect. Like, I just graduated and currently working from home. But so, yeah.
All right. So we can have like a certain group sort of a thing, and we can come up with a domain and triggers for that, and we can try developing a toolkit and actually having visuals to various ideas of futures. And okay.
With a very plug-like interest, I will say that if you guys continue the conversation on HasGeek comments, it might become a space for all of us to safely talk about more about this subject and build ourselves within that sphere. They are kind of like very open, and also in terms of sort of strong understanding of code of conduct and general ethics. So perhaps a good place to take this conversation further without feeling ki Zoom Chinese hai or something like that.
Right.
Yeah, we guys are very open on this concern. So please feel free to contact us, even if you want to just do a short discussion with us. So because we are always prepped up to talk about speculative design from different perspective, obviously.
Also, Yathart, can you leave your email ID? Or I can just get it from the list of attendees.
Doc.
If you're registered. So I can actually write you back after, reading the thing. Because I think we can have a conversation there also.
Yeah, I think we have his email.
All right, guys. I think we, if anyone has any more questions, you can just
email us DM us on Instagram or whatever.
Just a quick question, how do you guys plan to take this out? Would we be having more discussion like this, or developing a base platform where everyone can contribute?
Yeah, from the next session onwards, so we'll probably have some documenting tools, like a workshop tools, as a enabler to the discussion. So all the discussions that we'll do will be channelized in some form or the other. And eventually what we lead up to is that one session or two sessions probably, we can then we take some time and work out where the discussion has extended to, all the extents of the discussions, what all was covered. So we have a process that is mostly very inclusive, in the sense that we try to address each and every extremity that comes up in the discussion. If someone says that that making a chipset is a craft, and someone says that weaving a sari is a craft, or someone says that making a particular culinary experience in terms of tastes is the craft. So we try to take all of the extremities into account, and then we come up with a toolkit, which takes some time, but then I think that is the way that we have been. So I think another documented discussion, and we'll have an activity associated with it by the end of the discussion. So we can have some form of visuals taking place of ideas in forms of collages, and then we also work upon the visuals a little further after the thing is done, and then we present it back to the group. So that is kind of our process. We take cues, then we share the ideas back, how we think about it, and then so it's like a to and fro thing. So we'll have activity from the next session. So it won't be a pure show and tell thing. It'll be a
All right, guys, thank you so much. Looking forward for it.
Thanks, Anuj.
Thanks, Anuj.
Okay, guys, I think we have extended our time. So thank you everyone for being here. And if you guys are interested, we'll keep you posted about the next session. So you guys want to discuss on the particular chosen topic, we all could be there. Okay.
All right. Thank you. Okay. Bye.
Thanks, Amol.
Thank you, Nishtha. Thank you, everyone.